Thank you very much for your introduction. So I'm Akira Naruse from NVIDIA. So I'm really honored to have this really valuable opportunity to give presentation to leading researcher in deep learning. So this today I would like to discuss these things. All you need is really only fast matrix multiplication for deep learning. So before getting into this topic, and I would like to briefly introduce our product. So as you might know, NVIDIA is not simple, hardware provider. Of course, we provide really enhanced GPU for deep learning. Now we have a Volta generation GPU named Tesla V100, and it has 125 teraflops by using a tensor core we introduced. It used both FP32 and FP16. We call it mixed precision. However, still, we have really nice FP32 teraflops. If you want to FP32, still it have 15 teraflops. And it also has really nice memory bandwidth. But at the same time, we also spend much time, much effort, much money for software development and enhancement. Now, as you might know, we have cuDNN that is specially designed for convolutional networks and RNNs, and we also have Kubras that is basically focusing on dense matrix, and also Cartras. This is a bit new, and maybe most of you don't know what Cartras is. Cartras is basically designed to some linear algebra solver that requires some kind of small dense matrix multiplication internally. And also we have NICU that is designed to accelerate communication between multiple GPUs and also multiple nodes. And also TensorRT, this is kind of graph compilation, and this is designed to train your trained model for inferencing, to accelerate actual inferencing processing on our, for example, Tegra or small GPUs. And also we provide some techniques how to use FP16 and FP32 with a Tensor Core. So, okay, back to the question, title. So as you might know, so our GPU is really faster in matrix multiplication compared to other processors. That is simply because most workload in deep learning, like convolution, fully connected layer, RNN, those kind of computation can be expressed in form of this matrix multiplication, dense matrix multiplication. But question is, imagine if there is a processor which is really focusing on fast matrix multiplication, fast dense matrix multiplication, can it greatly accelerate your workload, including CNN, RNN, etc.? And our answer is probably no. Workload in deep learning is not that simple. Matrix multiplication, yes, it's really important. However, it's not only important things in deep learning. Let me give some example through this context. One example is this one. This is, CNN, and the breakdown of what component is actually spend CPU time or GPU time while training this model. And this actually graph shows the x-axis shows elapsed time per one iteration, including forward pass, backward pass, and update. And this is actually training ImageNet using Resident 50 that is really typical, CNN these days, and using 120 batch size. And first, this is a bit off topic, but good thing is when you use Volta V100 with TensorRT, you can get 3x performance. But important point here is not that one. As you can see, convolutions, this light green box shows time to spend convolution. As you can imagine, convolution is really dominant in CNN. However, probably not that dominant as you expected. It is just 60% of time in full iteration. And actually, our Tensor Core can accelerate, matrix multiplication. So if you use a V100 convolution time, of course, you can get really shrinked. You can train this model with really small amount of time, but, convolution actually only occupy nearly 50%. So as a component, as a workload, it's also very important. And this is just one example. So now you have various kind of convolution, like grouped convolution, deleted convolution, depth-wise convolution, and not only convolution, but also many solvers, many techniques have been proposed and realized these 5 years since AlexNet broke human optimized model. So we believe this kind of trend will continue for coming years, at least some kind of programmability still necessary in deep learning community. And the next example is this one. So as you can see, now we have to handle really huge data set. So and to cope with this growth of data set, now it is getting typical to use multiple GPU or multiple node for accelerate your training. And nowadays, very typical way to use a multiple GPU or a multiple node is to use so-called synchronous data parallelism way. In that way, each worker, each GPU, or each node have exactly same copy of parameters. And each worker receive different data set. And each GPU worker perform forward and backward in completely independently. And after getting gradients of weight, they exchange weight using so-called old reduced communication. So in this part, communication, high performance bandwidth in we sometimes call interconnect. High performance interconnect is going to be necessary here. And actually, so this is actually result of PNN. And as you can see, now we can finish ImageNet training in 15 minutes by using 1024 GPUs. And this graph shows how much time is actually spent for communication. So green dot line shows actual time spent for each iteration for communication. So as you can see, communication is important. Important, however, looks it's not that important, but probably communication is going to be more important because data parallelism is not the only way to use multiple GPU or multiple nodes. So this is not new. This is rather old technique. This is called model parallelism. So, but this kind of workload is very often to see in kind of natural processing and sound processing because it is notoriously known that many huge parameter is going to be necessary to train language model, etc. In that case, the model size is too large to fit full parameter into single GPU, even with 16 gigabyte GPUs. So in that case, parameter is going to be distributed over GPUs. So naturally, all data generated from this GPU should be passed going to another GPUs. Naturally, more bandwidth for interconnection is going to be necessary. So another trend is this one. Maybe some already know this one, graph convolution. Graph convolution is a kind of, even though name is convolution, this is not convolution. However, this is, I know this still there is a controversy between this method is effective or not, but some researcher found this is really nice to find some future from huge set of graph. So I'm not going to detail about what graph convolution is today, but simply I would discuss what kind of workload is going to be necessary for GPU or CPU. So this kind of computation is going to be necessary if you want to perform graph convolution so effectively. So that is sparse matrix multiplication, because graph is nothing but sparse matrix. Naturally, you should handle sparse matrix very effectively. And also, interesting point is if you have this calculation in forward pass, this calculation is going to be necessary in backward pass. So interesting part is here. So you have to perform dense matrix multiplied by dense class and generating sparse matrix. This is kind of beyond our expectation, but this now we are kind of requesting to support this kind of workload in context of graph convolution. And this is this is just a preliminary result on graph convolution. And still, as I mentioned, our library does not have API for this workload. So we simply implemented how much performance we can actually get by this graph convolution. So this graph shows performance, in this case, time required for one iteration. And the blue box shows time on CPU. And the green box is time on GPU. Y-axis, please note that y-axis is not linear. It is written in log scale because there is so much performance difference between CPU and the GPU. And I have to say, this is not fair competition because we only use one core for CPU. But probably you can guess what kind of time or performance can be obtained if you use full core, like 20 cores. Still, if you use full core on CPU, there is a significant gap between a CPU and a GPU. So this kind of workload is probably going to be necessary in coming years. So okay, going back to first question, all you need is fast dense matrix multiply? No, you will need all. You will need the whole for like a cryptocurrency. As you might know, several years ago, cryptocurrency is basically backed by ASICs. However, well, now we have so many cryptocurrency, so many fast function. You have to, adopt so many variety of workloads. That's why now GPU is getting used for cryptocurrency. But I'm not saying please do not use our GPU for this one. Please use our GPU for deep learning. Okay, and actually, use of GPU for this kind of mining internally is strictly prohibited. And this is what I actually want to say. So as you might know, HPC workload is very diverse. Some application requires really high flops, high teraflops, and some requires high memory bandwidth. And in some case, really high network bandwidth is going to be necessary. So our guess is workload of deep learning is getting similar, like workload in HPC. And one day, doesn't make sense to have separate computer resource, one for HPC and one for deep learning. And I don't know when it will happen, but probably those kind of system is going to be integrated, and both for HPC and deep learning. And one more thing, I forget to introduce myself. Let me spend some time for my introduction. I'm Akira Naruse. My title is Senior Developer Technology Engineer. It's a kind of senior software engineer. And my expertise is parallel computing and computer architecture and HPC and nowadays deep learning. And so my mission is actually to bridge your needs and our GPU computing. Because to be honest, how to effectively use GPU is not that simple. So please tell me your workload. Then I would help to accelerate your workload. I'm really happy, and if we can support your workload, we can accelerate your, scientific discovery, of course, with our GPUs. Thank you.